Okay. Pretend that it is 3 years ago, and George W. Bush is in the White House, and Alberto Gonzalez is the Attorney General. And you're attending a conference on terrorism recruitment tactics. It's a scholarly conference. And you learn that web-based communities play a major role. Suppose further that you have a small collection of keywords that are guaranteed to bring you to relevant sites. In other words, you know exactly what to search for. You're intensely curious intellectually about these sites. The question is, do you think twice about making the search query? Now, against this backdrop, I want to quickly establish two cliches. The first one, and I'll take my first slide, is that the internet holds enormous promise. I'm not going to go through these, but I will highlight in particular searching. I put search in a separate category for several reasons. It's intensely personal. If you track my searches, you know what I'm working on, you know what I'm thinking about for the future. You find out which fundamental equations and inequalities I can absolutely never remember. You know what my daughter is studying in her history class. You know who has applied for a job in my research group. And you know what I'm thinking about. And I also believe that search is absolutely indispensable in order to be competitive in today's world. So you really don't have a choice about whether or not you are going to search for things. Okay. The second cliche is that there's an enormous privacy threat on the internet. It's not just obvious tracking and recording, but even the means for a different sort of invasion of privacy, which is gaining access to people. An example that I discovered something called Face Connector, which was formerly FaceForce. It's a mashup of Salesforce.com and Facebook. And Salesforce.com provides customer relationship management applications allowing you to track recruiting and customer leads. And Face Connector integrates this information with Facebook information. And there's a demo that you can find on the web. And the commentary that accompanies the demo talks about taking the Facebook information that you have for your new leads and using the information in there to start up a conversation with your recruitment targets. Okay, so somehow, although they emphasize that we're only using self-published information, something feels wrong about this. And we'll get back to it at the end of the talk. Okay. Now, privacy is poorly understood. This is actually not a cliche because the depths to which privacy is poorly understood is actually astonishing. This famous picture illustrates how Sweeney was able to identify the medical records of Governor William Weld of Massachusetts by linking voter registration records, which are public, with publicly released so-called anonymous Massachusetts Group Insurance Commission medical encounter data. And she noticed that the three fields of birth date, sex, and zip code were contained in both types of records, and that with this information you could actually uniquely identify 87% of the American population. At least that's the claim. Okay. Now, linkage attacks predated Sweeney's work. And the Census Bureau routinely considers existing databases with linkage attacks in mind before releasing data. But Sweeney's work galvanized the community. And in fact, it kicked off about a decade of completely misguided work in which solutions to an imperfectly formulated problem were proposed, broken, repaired, reproposed, broken, repaired, and so on and so forth. Now, I'm actually the optimist in this panel, I think. Well, I mean, this is how I described myself. Before explaining why I'm actually optimistic, I want to point out that the setting that we're discussing right here in this slide in private data mining is about as pure a privacy problem as we could hope for. We have a trusted curator who has gathered data, who is not trying to do something nefarious, and who wishes for the public good to release statistical information. So there's no talk of access control or tampering with the data or anything like this. It's purely privacy. And by the way, never believe it if somebody says they have anonymized data. Just don't believe it. Okay. So why am I optimistic? I'm inspired by the tremendous achievements of modern cryptography. It seems that in cryptography, we have been able to do essentially anything that we want to do. Not only can we do now ordinary things like digital signatures and even public key encryption, but we can do extraordinary things. For example, I can prove to you the existence of a needle in an exponentially large haystack without revealing to you anything about the location or the shape of the needle. And you'll only be convinced if it's actually true. It's amazing what can be done. More important, though, even than the specifics, is the general example that was provided by modern cryptography in finding the right mathematical definitions of social problems or social goals, and given a proposed construction, providing a rigorous proof that the construction satisfies the definition. The bottom line is that it is possible to get it right. How am I in time? Okay. So this success in cryptography has to a sizable extent been replicated in the private data mining problem that we talked about earlier. And again, the setup is a trusted and a trustworthy agent that has collected highly sensitive information and which wishes to release statistics without compromising the privacy of any of the people in the data set. Hal said earlier that better monitoring led to better contracts. Alfred Kinsey, in collecting his data on human sexual practices, understood that better privacy meant better data. If he could ensure privacy, subjects would be more willing to speak to him. The implications of success here are enormous. We could have analysis of Kinsey's data, medical data, scholastic data, financial data, just to name a few areas. And addressing Henry Brady's concern, it gives a way for Google and Microsoft and other large corporate corporations to unlock the social value in their data vaults if they choose to by making these data available to social scientists for research. This is what we call a differentially private map of Bay Area commutes. It was drawn by my colleague, Frank McSherry. To have your commute included here, you have to have one endpoint of your commute within a certain location in San Francisco, within 5 miles of a certain, one endpoint within in San Francisco and the other endpoint 5 miles away or less. No, I said that wrong. The 5 mile radius is in San Francisco, and then people could start from wherever they want. Okay, sorry. Now, it's not surprising to you that this is a private map. I mean, there are no names on it. But suppose I told you a lot of extra information. Suppose I told you all of the original data items except possibly one. And the possible one would be where the starting point is of my commute. And suppose for every pixel you see there, I tell you exactly the location of the pixel. So you can completely deconstruct this data. Still, with all of that extra information, you would not be able to tell even whether my data had been included in the map, let alone where the other endpoint of my commute is. And this would hold no matter what data source you could link to. The accuracy-privacy trade-off is also now much better understood. So in this example, we've taken population data, only we weren't allowed to have access to the population data from the Census Bureau because it's considered private. So we used instead traffic intersections. And so the map has been broken into a grid, and we've counted how many traffic intersections are in each grid cell. And on the left, you see the noisy version of the data, the one that's been generated in a privacy-preserving fashion. On the right, you see the errors that we introduced. That's right, you can't see them. There are, but if we were to really strongly increase the privacy, you could see a little bit more. And then if we really turned it way up, you could see a lot more. Okay. Now for my last slide. Again, privacy-preserving data analysis is a very, very pure privacy case. And the science smiled favorably. But there are a lot of other facets of privacy, and each one is highly nuanced. How can we possibly hope to address them? So remember I emphasized getting the right definitions. To do this, we actually turned to philosophers, whom I view as the investigators of the principles of values. For example, Gavison writes about one aspect of privacy, which is the protection from being brought to the attention of others, pointing out that beyond the attention itself, after all, when we walk down the street, we want to feel that we're relatively anonymous, nobody is staring at us. Beyond the attention itself, once attention has been drawn to us, this invites further compromise of privacy. Unfortunately, attention is not anymore just what humans are capable of. We have computers now that can pay attention, and that's much, much more powerful and much more insidious. So we need to go further. Now, Nissenbaum, writing about public surveillance in the digital age, ties privacy protection to norms of specific contexts. Her profound contributions help us to understand, first of all, what was wrong in that face connector example that I gave to you. What was wrong, she would say, is that a certain norm of appropriateness had been compromised, that information that was being given in one context, the Facebook stuff, was turned and being used in a different context. What happened when Thelma Arnold, the AOL user, had her search query history revealed? Remember that AOL published a bunch of so-called anonymous query logs, replacing IP addresses with a random address, and reporters were able to track down a specific user and understand and see what her concerns were. What Nissenbaum would say is that a norm of information flow had been compromised, and Thelma Arnold thought so as well. And she said, this sort of thing shouldn't happen to anybody. We have a right to privacy. So in conclusion, there are a lot of problems out there, but based on the example from cryptography and supported by progress that we've had in private data mining, I am optimistic. Thank you.